Shalom, everybody. Welcome to today's edition where we're reading from The Final Frontier. This is the book on near-death experiences, incredible stories, some of heaven, some of hell. And I will be reading it to you. So the first one I'm going to read is The Engineering Officer. It's the story of Gerard Dunphy from Ireland. This was a headache of mammoth proportions. It was May 20th, 1982, and I was at home in bed. Pam, my wife, had gone into town and I was alone with our 15-month-old baby. As the morning wore on, the headache grew even worse until suddenly I felt something snap in my head. I didn't know what it was, but I knew it was serious. Knowing I needed help, I called out to God. There were a number of things not right in my life, so I promised if I get through this problem, I'll straighten everything out. At this point, I became concerned for the baby who was on my bed. I managed to get hold of her by the leg, put her onto the floor and drag her down the landing to the back room where I locked her in. I then crawled back to my bedroom, got to the window and called out to my neighbours who were outside at time for help. I was sent by ambulance to the hospital where I was examined and had a lumbar puncture. A brain hemorrhage was diagnosed. They transferred me to the regional hospital where the specialist arranged for a CAT scan. I had an angiogram the next morning to look for blocked arteries and woke up 9 hours later in the recovery room after surgery. Then I lapsed into a coma. The prognosis was poor. I was put onto a life support machine, but as the clock ticked on, I slipped into a deeper coma. Evidently, I was in that coma for days with no change except that the specialist told my wife I did not have fully fixed or dilated pupils, nor a temperature of over 106 degrees Fahrenheit. Pam did not understand the medical terms, so asked a cousin of hers who was a nursing sister. She said that I was on the brink of death, but had not quite reached the point of death. The cousin asked Pam if she'd ever heard of the healing power of God and slipped a piece of paper with a telephone number into her hand. That night, Pam rang the number and spoke to a man, Al Ryan, who was the president of the local chapter of the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship. When she told him the problem, there was a moment's silence. Then Al said, "Mrs. Dunphy, your husband will recover." Somehow Pam knew deep down that his words were true. Al then asked for 3 days of prayer and fasting. Pam's cousin contacted as many people as she could, requesting their prayer support. It was put out on the local radio Christians program, and prayer groups around the country were contacted. That Sunday evening, all of my family gathered to pray for me. This kind of meeting was new to the family. It was the last resort. What Pam didn't know at that time was that all my family had actually gathered to say their goodbyes to me. My brother had even come over from England. The night after the prayer meeting, Pam and her cousin came to visit. They noticed a slight change in my condition. When they spoke to me, my eyelids fluttered. Her cousin went out and spoke with the people monitoring my condition and asked if there had been any change. "No," they said. 2 hours after they left, the hospital contacted my family. I was conscious. I knew where I was, what had happened to me, and even my name. I could see clearly and even read. The next morning, the specialist informed my wife, "I'm delighted to say that your husband will recover." That evening, however, Pam was asked to go to the doctor's office. This was just 12 hours after my miraculous recovery. The doctor said to her, "Mrs. Dunphy, I'm very sorry to tell you that your husband has contracted bacterial pneumonia, and I have arranged for a second opinion from another specialist." Pam said that she still had absolute faith I would be healed. The following morning, they did a tracheotomy, a small incision in the windpipe to help me breathe. Coming out of surgery, I slipped back into a coma. Pam's cousin knew the second specialist they had called in and asked for his diagnosis. He said I had a very serious condition which I might not survive. But Al Ryan had not given up. At 6 in the evening, he came into the hospital holding a big Bible. He and Pam came into the intensive care unit where he prayed for me. He put his hands on me and began praying. Then he stopped. "Jared's spirit is gone." He went on to explain that he was going to pray that if I had not seen the light of heaven, God would allow me to return. He prayed quietly for a few minutes and then began to pray for healing. As he did, Pam could feel heat coming from my chest and my eyelids began to flicker, just as they had done on the previous Sunday. Then I heard Al say, "You know who's here, don't you?" I nodded my head and he gave a prayer of thanksgiving. I put my hands together and endeavoured to mouth the words Al prayed. The following day, I was awake and alert. 3 days later, when the chest specialist returned, he was delighted to see me up and walking about. The tubes in my chest were removed, and after 1 week since I was improving, 2 weeks later, I was released from hospital. Of course, I was aware of very little of what went on during that time, as far as the hospital and surroundings were concerned. What I do know is that during the second coma, I had a sensation of my spirit leaving my body. I felt drawn to a light at the end of a long tunnel. To my left, I saw a white horse in full gallop. Then I came to a tunnel to the right. I stopped in front of it and heard a voice. It asked me three questions about my love for my wife and children, after which it went on to say that love was the key to the kingdom. It also said I would have to come back to earth. I then returned to my body and regained consciousness. Out of gratitude, Pam started attending prayer meetings regularly. At first I went along too, but soon began to feel like an exhibit. After a while I stopped going. Then they did not give up on me though, they continued to pray for me. 9 months later I asked my wife to get a babysitter so that I could come with her to the prayer meeting that night. About a year later we went to the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship Convention in Blarney. On the Saturday evening I went to the front and asked one of the men to pray for me. I committed my life to Jesus Christ that night. As that man continued to pray for me, I reached into my pocket, took out my cigarettes, threw them on the floor and stamped on them. I tried unsuccessfully to stop smoking before. Since that time, I've not touched a cigarette. The urge to smoke went completely. Before this experience, my whole life was in a mess. If God had not stepped in, Pam and I would surely have separated. In the period after my miraculous healing and my commitment to Jesus, God began dealing with my problems one by one. From that time, I've experienced God's help and guidance in all areas of my life. So that is the story of Jared Dunphy from Ireland. And if you want to make heaven your home, just as he has now made heaven his home by believing in Jesus, that he died and rose again, you can do that tonight. You can do that right now, today. You can just say, Lord, if what she's telling me is true, that you are the creator of the universe, that you love me, and that you died on the cross for me and you rose again, well, I want to believe it, Lord. Help me with my unbelief. And Lord, do not let me die until I become born again. Make sure that I do not leave this earth without knowing you. They're the sort of prayers that you pray to God. Just speak from your heart and he hears. He hears every single prayer and thing you say, even if it's just in your thought. So you can get this book, okay, a free copy of this book on Yeshua Square, The Final Frontier, and you can read the life experiences, some of heaven, some of hell, yourselves. All right, remember Jesus loves you and he created you for a purpose and he wants you to be in the kingdom of God, but you must believe in Jesus, that he died and rose again, and repent to enter the kingdom of heaven. There is no other way. There is by no other path, only through Jesus to heaven. All right, so until the next time, I will see you again soon. Bye for now.